Hi folks, and welcome back to another video. Ubuntu 20.04 LTS is just around the corner. Let's take a look at it and what it brings new to the table. So without any further ado, let's get started. Let's begin with the desktop. The new Ubuntu 20.04 LTS comes with GNOME 3.36. and an updated Yaru theme. If you stuck with 18.04 for the past year or so, because of the long-term support, the looks are going to be a big surprise. Because just like Ubuntu 19, the ambience theme is gone, in favor of the flat look of Yaru. But it's not the same Yaru, because there have been minor tweaks to make it look better. To start with, the top bar items, the calendar, and the drop-down menu in the top right now have a light background, instead of the dark background. Also, purple is now more present in the scene, appearing in toggles and progress bars as well, balancing the orange accent color that Ubuntu had for so many years. It might seem like a very minor detail, and most of you will not really care, but the cursor look has also been updated, so the select is now light instead of dark. Speaking of light and dark, Ubuntu now comes with a light mode, a dark mode, and a standard mode. Just like in the previous version, there was radiance. Now Ubuntu allows customization to get a light appearance with a light mode, with everything light. And also a very requested feature, the dark mode, which is applied system-wide. All apps that come default support it, from settings to file explorer and many more. The only things I noticed not getting dark were the top bar right-click menu, the drop-down menu, and the calendar. Icons have also been updated, receiving a more polished look, and the folder icons are now gray instead of orange as they previously were. But the new Ubuntu is not just looks and a dark mode. Just like in Ubuntu 19.10, in the terminal there still is a fine tool incorporated in the title bar, new for people coming from the old LTS release, and I really found it helpful. GNOME was always known for being very taxing on a GPU, poorly optimized and with many frame drops. And on the older Ubuntu 18.04, I really noticed it. Frame drops occurred, at least on my laptop, at almost every animation, and performance was getting worse and worse the more extensions you put on it. The new GNOME, though, is very light. I was very surprised that in 2 days I had no frame drops. Not on battery, and even lowering frequencies for better battery, and still no frame drops. GNOME is now really good, and coming from the old version of Ubuntu, it feels smoother than any desktop interface I ever tested. The animations run at max frame rate, with no issues whatsoever, something I never expected GNOME to do this soon, considering how bad performance was in the previous version. Even putting 6 extensions seemed to not do anything to its performance. I was genuinely impressed. One thing that Ubuntu was lacking for the past years, compared to other distros, is the Do Not Disturb button, but now it's included. Better late than never. Also, there now is fractional scaling. If on your high-resolution monitor things look too small, you can increment your scaling by 25% a step, up to 200%. This is post-production me. Apparently, your scaling options depend on your resolution, so a higher resolution will unlock more scaling options. For instance, on a 1440p display, you will have 300% scaling option, but on a 720p display, you will not. You will have no scaling options whatsoever. Also, on fractional scaling, you can't get to 300%, only from 100 to 200, but on lower resolution you can get less scaling options. The new lock screen is just gorgeous, and the login screen also got a refreshed look, which looks way more polished than before. The Ubuntu Dock can now be disabled, as it now is recognized in the GNOME tweak tool as an extension. You can't configure it though, and it is recognized as a trimmed down version of the dash to dock extension. Ubuntu now also supports 10-bit colors, if you can afford one of those monitors, but I don't think it will make a difference in day-to-day usage. One major difference is now made by software. The older GNOME Software Center has been replaced by the Snap Store, but this is not that big news, it's just the way that software is packaged. Also showing that Canonical wants to push snaps more, the terminal now first recommends you snap packages and then APT, compared to just APT in the past. Ubuntu 20.04 now comes with Open Java Development Kit 11, Rust 1.41, GCC 9.3, Ruby 2.7.0, Python 3.8.2, PHP 7.4, Perl 5.3, and Golang 1.13 pre-installed. But the real change is the kernel. We can all manually install toolchains, and anyway, in a couple of months, they will need updates. Even though at the point of filming this video, there already is kernel 5.6.2, the 5.4 Linux kernel has the guaranteed stability that LTS promises. The new version of Ubuntu comes with broader hardware support and improved ZFS support. Transferring files from Linux to Windows and vice versa has always been quite a struggle for me. NTFS wouldn't always mount correctly, and FAT is very limited. Maximum file size is 4 GB on FAT. But this problem is now solved thanks to the new kernel, which supports extended FAT. This has almost unlimited file size, and it's great for my common partitions between the two OSs. As I said, Ubuntu 20.04 LTS does not come with kernel version 5.6, but it is backporting WireGuard from it. The kernel and INI TramFS compression algorithms has changed to LZ4 to deliver faster boot times, but to be honest, I didn't really notice any speed increase. To be fair, on this SSD, I get boot times after the post of around 2 to 3 seconds, so I can't complain. Speaking of included things, the Amazon app is now removed, and I might say it's for the best. For this version of Ubuntu, some package names have been changed, which meant that some of the software did not find its dependencies, and that I had to manually go in the Debian file and edit the dependencies to match the new package names. This is to be expected since this is a beta version of Ubuntu. But my advice to you is to not update to Ubuntu 20 straight away. Wait some time, 2 weeks, or a month, or maybe two, so that the third-party software has enough time to update their dependencies to match the new package names. Battery life is okay, but not amazing in my opinion. That statement, though, needs a bit more testing, since I've been using Ubuntu just for a couple of days. Overall, I really like Ubuntu 20.04. It's definitely an improvement over Ubuntu 19 and 18, and it's not a huge difference. It's just a bit tweaked, but it feels way more polished. It's very good looking out of the box, and much faster than the older versions. The addition of the dark mode is something that everybody was expecting, but it will not work on third-party themes. Thank you guys for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. And if you want to see more videos like this one, hit the subscribe button. See you next time on How to IT.